Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode 18 of Right on Point. I'm Olivia Ingracia.
And I'm Paul Ingracia. Today, we're excited to bring you all a very highly anticipated interview with Dr. Patrick Deneen, a political science professor at Notre Dame, whose new book, Why Liberalism Failed, is making the headlines everywhere. So, without further ado, let's begin. So before we begin our interview, I wanted to say beforehand, today's guest, Professor Deneen, has contributed a very important piece of literature in his work, Why Liberalism Failed, which attempts to deal seriously with the current philosophical crisis, which came at least politically to the forefront following the surprising results of 2016, and in particular, Donald Trump's election and the Brexit. However, Professor Deneen's thesis goes well beyond the political exterior by engaging intellectually with the founding principles of modern liberalism, that is to say, the birth of a philosophical order whose origins are evidenced in what Deneen himself describes the proto- or pre-liberal ideas of John Locke, Thomas Hobbes, and Niccolo Machiavelli. Modern society is in large part viewed as having been deeply conjoined to these enlightened precepts. They were largely the source of the political thought of our founding fathers and have since almost reconceptualized what liberalism or liberty means in the modern sense, and have arguably, as a consequence of their historical development, radically altered the very meaning of being itself. Speaking more concretely, the West appears to be blighted despite its historic prosperity that we are experiencing as of present by an insidious contagion or disease that is at least in part linked to this problem or question of philosophical liberalism and its effects on a modern technological and global society. Socially, we have observed, especially over the past 50 years or so, rising secularism all throughout the West, and its monumental effects on the family and social unity. In light of these realities, we invited Mr. Deneen to provide a studied take on the changing world and how that changing world comports or contradicts classical philosophy, that is to say, the philosophy of the ancient Greeks and Christianity, and what actions we could or should take politically, philosophically, intellectually, to preserve the very best of our inheritance. Patrick Deneen is professor of political science at the University of Notre Dame. Prior to joining the faculty at Notre Dame in 2012, he taught at Princeton University and Georgetown University. Professor Deneen also has written four books, including The Odyssey of Political Theory, Democratic Faith, Conserving America, and most recently, Why Liberalism Failed, which appeared in January 2018 with Yale University Press. In addition to academic work, he frequently writes for journals of opinion, including First Things and the American Conservative. So, Mr. Deneen, thank you for joining us today. I hope I got everything right in that bio, and we appreciate your time.
Thanks for having me.
I want to begin by just asking you just a general question about what inspired you to take up this project, Why Liberalism Failed. Was it a political or intellectual experience or some combination of both of those? In your own words, what do you mean by liberalism and what was the impetus behind this work?
Well, it largely arises out of my study of the history of political thought and conclusions that I've drawn over a long period of time in studying the history of political thought. But of course, it's not just a, it doesn't aim to be, and I don't think anyone even working at the level of political theory is simply engaging in the study of philosophy in the absence of thinking about sort of where the rubber hits the road, sort of the practical world of politics. And so I would say that the project really, at its heart, is an effort in some ways to diagnose something of our current condition in light of what I see as sort of deeper fundamental truths that I've been really working through, and conclusions I've been drawing based on a more sort of philosophical study. So it's really an effort to kind of combine theory and practice. I think that's at our best, that's what political philosophers do. We don't always hit the mark, but I think at least at the moment, I seem to have hit a moment in which a lot of people are concerned about the fate and prospects for liberal democracy.
Right. And for our listeners, I mean, I understand it's a very complicated question, but can you define what liberalism means?
Well, sure. I mean here, and this is to, you know, to touch on this more philosophical background. I really mean not the kind of way we talk about liberalism in the everyday political world as sort of the political left as opposed to conservatism. Mm-hmm. I really mean liberalism as a kind of, you know, roughly 500-year project that, in my view, was really an effort to redefine the nature of liberty. You know, at the heart of the word liberalism is the word liberty. Mm-hmm. It's a very old word. It has very ancient roots. It goes back to ancient Rome, and before that, there's a Greek variant word of for liberty. It's a very old concept. But my argument is that really in the early modern period, really beginning with almost a proto-liberal thinker of Thomas Hobbes, and then sort of more developed within the liberal worldview of John Locke. That really Locke is the, in many ways, the architect of the modern liberal project.
Right.
Liberty is defined from being, you could say, a concept of what it is we achieve when we have a rightly ordered soul and a rightly ordered society. And in other words, in particular, a life lived in accordance with virtue aimed at a conception of the good. And the effort by liberalism is to say we're not going to, as a society, debate over questions of the good anymore. We're going to use the philosophical term, we're going to bracket questions of the good. And instead, liberty will really be the ability of people to pursue their own conception of what the good is, as long as they don't bump up into or harm other people. And so liberty comes to mean the absence of external constraints to the practice of my personal definition of what liberty is. And that really is the origins of what I see as the liberal political project, which of course is not simply limited to politics, but ultimately transforms all aspects of human life, which is really the argument of the book.
Right, and this book has become one of the most discussed works since the events of 2016, especially among conservative publications and intellectual circles. Even Barack Obama cited it as one of the books he was reading this summer. Given this outsized influence on our cultural and political conversations, how might your ideas translate to future public policy, or at least how we treat this liberal philosophical project in the future?
Oh, that's a big question. I guess I would take some issue with the idea that it's exerting a lot of influence. I think what it's done is it was published at a moment complete surprise to me when again a more philosophic argument really matched kind of contemporary events, a kind of sense that you know, the system itself was on the verge of a kind of failure. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't simply that, you know, there was a need for, you know, a kind of reform on the electoral side, you know, a change of the primary rules,
right,
or a change of party platform. I think along the political spectrum, you mentioned both conservative readers of the book as well as Barack Obama. Across the political spectrum, there's a widespread sense that this liberal project is in crisis. And so I would say that rather than necessarily being a book that's influenced you know, direct policy questions, what it's done is it's prompted discussion of whether there are inherent shortcomings to this big political architecture of modern liberalism. And in turn, what I think the consequence of this is that we tend the discussion, at least around my book, has been less about specific policy than it is about whether in some ways there's a need for a foundational reconsideration of our political order. And so you could say that policy is kind of like the app of a political system.
Right.
And what we're talking about is the operating system
right now. Yeah.
And if you change your operating system, then the kinds of policy questions that arise would be very different. Would be quite different. So I would say that if there's influence, it's really simply to propose a more foundational set of examinations of our order. Mm-hmm. That said, it's certainly the case that there are people. I actually just spent the weekend visiting with a congressman at his home district. He wanted to have me up to talk about the book, and there was some discussion about more policy-oriented kinds of possibilities that that might arise from the analysis. And I guess the one thing that arose from those discussions was the conclusion that so many of our policy debates tend to take the form of either what in the book I describe as right liberalism or left liberalism, the kind of debates that we're used to, the debates between conservatives and liberals in our political system, which in my view has largely been left liberals and right liberals, with the debate in particular focused over whether it's market solutions or statist solutions that best address our sets of political problems. And the interesting consequence of those discussions this weekend was this congressman, along with some of his staff and some of his supporters, I think were really open to different ways of thinking about policy that put a lot more emphasis upon local kinds of solutions, thinking in terms of what people could themselves, how they themselves could resolve many of the deepest issues of our time. One thing we discussed was whether or not there was some way to measure Social Security benefits, not simply based on the amount of time you spent in work, but could you count, for example, the amount of time a mother or father has spent at home raising their children toward Social Security benefits. In other words, valuing the kind of work that we haven't tended to value as a society, and thinking about what are the benefits to good, solid, functioning, stable families in solving many of our country's problems, not this piece of public policy or that market-based solution. So I thought that was really an interesting set of discussions.
Yeah, and I mean, I think that's very interesting, and I apologize also over the course of this interview if some thoughts are left unanswered. We just have a lot of questions we want to ask you, including one submitted to our listeners, so just wanted to make that clear. I wanted to stay on this subject of politics for one more question. I recently came back from a fellowship with the Catholic University through the Thomistic Institute, and I had a conversation with Robert Royal, who told me he was a friend of yours. And he gave a speech describing the crux of the modern political dilemma, which is that of two different metaphysics, in his words, which are essentially diametrically at odds in the body politic, and each of which roughly aligns with the two major political parties. In 2016 kind of really crystallized those fault lines and basically claims half the population. The first is a traditional definition of being that rests fundamentally, as what you pointed out earlier, on a classical ontology of man. That is to say, man is teleologically ordered to a higher communal good, ultimately from God. And one is also reminded of St. Thomas Aquinas' definition of the natural law, which is an ordinance of reason for the common good made by him who has care of the community and promulgated. The second metaphysics is an enlightened metaphysics centered on promoting individual autonomy and securing its preconditions. You talked about Locke. You could also obviously see it in Hobbes, and then the logical extension to Rousseau and Nietzsche. I wanted to ask you if do you believe this is a valid breakdown of the current political divide? And is it fair to view liberalism as a single political stream whose origins roughly begin with Machiavelli or Hobbes and Locke, and which has reached pretty much its culmination in today's political and social phenomena? I know that's a loaded question, but if you could address at least, you know, some of those points.
I guess I would say I do consider Robert Royal to be a friend of mine, and we've known each other many years. And I wish this were the political divide that he describes. I think it is. There's a subset of one part of the political divide in some ways that reflects at least partially the kind of two metaphysics that you've described.
Right.
But I think the argument in my book and the argument I would make more broadly is that by and large, modern people in a modern liberal democratic society are largely shaped by the second metaphysics.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
In other words, that's the regime. And if Aristotle's right, and frankly, if Thomas Aquinas is right, the regime shapes us. It shapes, in many ways, our worldview and our horizon.
Yeah.
And so for many people who describe themselves as conservatives, think about probably people you've encountered, they are no less they no less embrace a certain conception of autonomy than people on the political left. It's simply a debate over whether or not in some ways that autonomy is best achieved, especially through the market. And the kinds of the conception of the human being that animates our view of the market. I mean, if you think of your basic economics 101 class,
right,
and the description of what is human nature, mm-hmm, the description of human nature exactly aligns with that second metaphysics. It's the utility maximizing. It's the Hobbesian individual in the state of nature in some ways, the utility maximizing individual who seeks to gain as much from interactions as possible. Mm-hmm. I do think, of course, that there is a subset largely within the conservative world that to a greater or lesser extent is shaped by the first of these metaphysics. Mm-hmm. Now, the difficulty that we confront in a liberal society is that even these people, unless you're educated in a certain way, and unless I think you've had a really distinct and in many ways countercultural formation, even the people in this first category tend to view this view of teleology as a personal and individual belief.
Mm-hmm.
And this is one of the great ironies and paradoxes of liberalism is that everything becomes the realm of opinion, the realm of individual opinion. And this is where we get into the kind of, you know, religion is my personal view, or my philosophy is my personal view, and it's not necessarily your view. But of course, if the first view is right, that we have human beings have a telos, that we are in some ways created in accordance with a certain order of the universe, then that's not simply true for me because I hold that opinion. That's true because it's true. And this is why in many ways I think even within what we could call the conservative world, there's a deep division. There's a division in some ways between these two metaphysics, right? So I would say that Robert Royal's correct that this is a worldview, but it's not in a way – I would say it doesn't have its own sort of party today, in a sense.
Yeah.
It's it's a relatively small subset within today's liberal society.
Yeah.
And I think it's one of the interesting things is as liberalism becomes more fully realized, more and more people of this first worldview that was described are beginning to realize that the belief that they hold is actually fundamentally contradictory to the liberal order. Mm-hmm. And this is where we're getting a lot of contemporary interest in and I think engagement with this question.
And that goes along with a question submitted by one of our listeners, Tim Colvin. He asks, how do you make the ordinary man realize this crisis of liberalism?
Well, write a book. we're talking about a regime, a political order, a way of life that at least by my by my reckoning, is the result of a series of debates and conclusions that took place at the level of sort of philosophic engagement and debate over the course of several centuries. Right? Of course, this interacted with the real world of politics, and lots of unpredictable and contingent historical events arise when that interaction happens. But still, it was, I think it's incontrovertibly the case that a really small number of very significant thinkers mm-hmm. reached certain conclusions that ended up influencing the broader society over a long term and in a very diffuse way. And so I think if we're going to get down to the level of how does the, you know, the working man, the lunch mm-hmm. bucket Joe, who's right. you know, busy, you know, working a you know 9 to 8 job or working overtime and then trying to get the kids to bed, how is that person going to engage this question? Mm-hmm. It's going to be in a much more diffuse way. But I do think it's important that these debates are being had even yeah. at fairly high levels of academics and yeah. influential, you know, intellectual leaders, journals, leaders of opinion, because this is how, in many ways, these ideas eventually sort of percolate down into everyday life.
So we want to thank Mr. Deneen very much for coming on the show and taking the time to discuss these important topics with us. And we will continue with the second half of the interview right away. But first, Paul had a comment to make about one of his questions he asked the professor.
If I mischaracterize your question, Mr. Royal, or really anything that Olivia and I say, any questions, any philosophical points, I urge you to email us. And I apologize as well. I may have... In pitching that question to Mr. Deneen, emphasized the more extreme arguments. I mean, understandably, I did not mean to convey that the two metaphysics being fought out in the political square are among basically Thomists and Nietzscheans. Obviously, no one is a large share of the population is. In the middle, somewhere in the middle of those two extremes. But I just wanted to make that point clearly. And I appreciate all of our listeners for tuning in today and for submitting questions.
Yes, we thank Mr. Colvin for submitting his question. It was great to hear Mr. Deneen's response. And Mr. Colvin is a big fan and supporter of our show, so we thank him. And if anyone else listening would like to send in a question for future interviews, you are more than welcome to. So thank you for listening so far to this interview edition of Right on Point. We hope you are enjoying this scintillating discussion. You can find us on iTunes, Google Play, Spotify, and Stitcher. So be sure that you are subscribed to us to never miss a podcast. Also, don't forget to find us on social media at twitter.com/ROP podcast, facebook.com/ROP podcast, and on Instagram at Right on Point Podcast. Let us know what you are thinking by writing a comment on iTunes, our website, or by emailing us at ROP@rightonpointpodcast.com, always to extend our discussion. Also, if you wanted simply bypass the liberal social media propaganda, feel free to visit our website, rightonpointpodcast.com, where you will be able to stay up to date, read articles, view extra content, and more.
In addition, we have emphasized in this and previous episodes, but I want to make the point again in our request to please support us by donating to our Patreon page at patreon.com/rightonpoint. If everyone listening would just donate $1 a month, we'd be better able to support our conservative community and continue to provide top quality content and solicit top quality interviews like Mr. Deneen for you all in the months ahead. It's a reputable, safe website, and we can really use your support, which will help to make our community and realize our conservative mission. That is patreon.com/rightonpoint. Now on to the second half of the interview.
I wanted to ask you, I mean, this is a difficult question, and I'm not sure if you'll be able to answer this, but based on the point you addressed earlier, the first metaphysics that based on a true communal good, which ultimately derives from the creator, from God, how do you explain the inevitability of liberalism's failure with Christianity as a historical religion? As to say that has a telos, a historical beginning and end. Should not liberalism, given its success, be construed as a providential process? And this was like, this was the worldview of Henry Adams, famously. He was plagued by this idea of liberalism and providence and how it might be a derivative of providence or driven by providence. If not, don't you risk suggesting that liberal societies over the past 500 or so years have been essentially founded on disordered precepts, as to say, against the natural order preordained by God?
Well, that's close to idolatry there, Paul. I think here a good dose of Augustinian both humility as well as the Augustinian understanding that no political order ultimately conforms to the city of God is really required. And here I think actually, I think there's a reason why the book has been debated and discussed by a wide array of different readers, different types of readers. But I think the readers that have probably been most engaged with it have been Christian readers. Mm-hmm. And I think the reason why is that, sort of deep in the formation of the Christian worldview is the understanding that there is no political order that ultimately conforms to the city of God, that the city of man is always a flawed vessel, and we're always always pilgrims until the final day. I think that there is a certain danger and even a tendency of humans in all times and in all places toward a kind of idolatry toward their political order. And this mm-hmm. is certainly what Augustine was confronting at the time of Rome's great conflagration and crisis in 410. Right. But I think this is a challenge always for Christians. I think the real challenge in many ways is for us to try to understand the role and the trajectory of providence with due acknowledgement of humility of our inability to know the will of God. Mm-hmm. And I guess I would just simply, I would conclude the following, that it may be that this is, as many human beings across the centuries have been faced with, an extraordinary variety of tests, that each age in some ways has to undergo a test. Mm-hmm. We can take all the way back to the ancient Israelites and all of the various tests that they go through. I think we're undergoing something of a test right now. Yeah. And it is in some ways a challenge to our comfort, especially for those of us living in the modern West. Literally our physical comfort as well as in many ways our political comfort that's developed certainly since the end of World War II. And I think we are undergoing something of a test right now. And it would be presumptuous and hubristic of me to presume to know where things are going. Mm-hmm. But I do think it is always necessary for a Christian to reflect on how the city of man is ultimately not whatever city we happen to live in is not our ultimate destination, mm-hmm. and has to be viewed with a certain degree of kind of psychic distance. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And do you see in your view that it is possible to renew a classical definition of liberty, one based on more pre-Enlightenment hermeneutic, and transpose that into today's politics?
Yeah, Olivia, I think that's a great question. It's the question. I think that we're to pick up on this discussion of providence again. Right. We've gone through this time of liberalism. We've gone through a time. We've gone through. Let's look at the long history. We've gone through a pre-modern time. We've gone through the division within the church that was established by Christ. The belief that it would be a unitary church has now become a highly divided church. And now we've gone through this period of time of liberalism, which in 1989, it was declared by Francis Fukuyama that this was the end of history, that there was nothing else left to debate at the level mm-hmm. of political regimes. And partly what my book is the effort to really say, look, I think that was premature, and we're not dismissed from the question of how to order our political lives together ever. But I do think that one of the ways in which maybe Providence is guiding us is that we are being called, I think your generation is being called, to articulate a new understanding of that classical notion of liberty mm-hmm. in light of what we have gone through, and in light of, in particular, what we see as the failings of this modern definition of liberty. Mm-hmm. It's not going to be simply, let's go back to Cicero and set up, you know, a Ciceronian politics. It's going to be, what do we do and how do we understand this in light of what we have passed through, which in many ways makes us much more conscious of the task. It makes us conscious of what's needed. And I think, too, what's interesting to me is if you think about what's happened in even the last 50 years or even last decade, the various churches, as well as the non-Christian more traditional religions, have discovered that they have more in common than they believed had divided them, particularly in light of the increasing hostility of modern secular liberalism. Mm. So there may be something providential in having had to go through this sort of cauldron of liberalism that might actually act as something of a repair upon the divisions within the various Christian denominations and more broadly within monotheism. Mm-hmm. So I think without knowing the direction of what we're going, and I do think in an interesting way, it's a real call to do the work of political theory as has been done in the past, not as an academic discipline, not as a professor trying to get tenure, but right. to figure out what it is we're doing, including right. how we think anew about this question of liberty.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Right. Your book has stimulated, obviously, a lot of deep thinking and reevaluating liberalism and its tenets and foundations and what we're essentially discussing today. I wanted to ask you about the criticism of your work, and I'm going to quote Dr. Adrian Vermeule of the Harvard Law School, who reviewed your work in the American Affairs Journal. In his article, Dr. Vermeule states, "At the stage of diagnosis, Deneen is masterful. At the stage of prescription, he relapses into liberalism, or more accurately, into liberalism's false image of itself." How do you respond to criticisms like that of Dr. Vermeule's that your work does not unearth an authentic post-liberal sort of alternative to liberalism? Is that possible to do, or must it be reconstructed out of liberalism? That's essentially the question.
Yeah. Oh no. I mean, I know Professor Vermeule. He's a friend of mine, and yeah. we've had these debates for some time now. yeah. I mean, I think his is something of it's a little bit of a misrepresentation, or at least a partial representation of the conclusion of my book. Mm-hmm. In the conclusion of my book, I argue that at the level of what is it that we can do right now, mm-hmm. I did conclude that, well, at the level of what we can do right now, maybe the best thing we can do is to seek to construct new forms of a kind of culture mm-hmm. that runs against what I describe in the book as the liberal anti-culture. Mm-hmm. And so I call this the construction of counter-anti-culture. And that this would take place largely at the level of homes and communities and neighborhoods and churches, parishes, communities, religious communities, and so forth. Right. And here I do invoke Rod Dreher's Benedict option, not mm-hmm. maybe not in quite the same way that Rod does, not as an effort to shroud ourselves or to protect ourselves from the mm-hmm. the encroachments of the broader culture, but as and I think, you know, in fairness to Rod, I think he sees this as preparatory work mm-hmm. to to something that will follow, right? And I think as Rod sees it, the Benedictine monasteries arise at the time of the fall of the Roman Empire in what's called the Dark Ages, and eventually give rise to Christendom in the European West, right? Mm-hmm. This is the core and right. the heart of what. So I think he sees these also as kind of preparatory to a kind yeah. of fundamental change. Okay. And what Professor Vermeule is rightly pointing out is that this proposal right now would take place within the context of liberalism.
Yeah.
In other words, it would seek to use the space that liberalism still, at least at some level, is able to afford communities to mm-hmm. pursue. I mean, there's always been space, for example, for the Amish to pursue the kinds of lives they want mm-hmm. to live. They don't have to live like liberal peoples. But that this would be a much more conscious effort of people to form an alternative way of being in the world to that of the liberal order. Mm-hmm. Now, at the same time, I agree with Professor Vermeule, this would only be probably temporary for two reasons. First of all, because it wouldn't be ultimately content with being a kind of subgroup of the society. It would seek to be evangelical. It would seek to say, look, this is the better way of life. Mm-hmm. And secondly, if threatened, the liberal order will fight back.
Yeah.
And that's certainly what we've seen in the efforts to restrain and restrict religious believers, religious liberty, and so forth. But, you know, I mean, the church, speaking as a Christian, the church has been threatened by the state many times in its long history and has, while not unbloodied, has always been triumphant in its mm-hmm. encounter with the state. It's a more powerful witness than what the state can ever bring to bear. But the mm-hmm. second part of my argument in that concluding chapter, which Professor Vermeule doesn't mention, is what we were just talking about, which mm-hmm. is the need for a reconception of our politics as a whole.
Yeah.
And I saw this as the work more of, I guess, what I could call elites, the, mm-hmm. the work of people who have the leisure and the training and kind of the position to engage in this kind of more philosophical, theoretical work. Mm-hmm. What Professor Vermeule, I think what he was really pointing to is that I'm missing a kind of middle dimension, mm-hmm. which is what do we do politically, right? So I talk about what we can do sort of personally as you know, living in families and communities and members of churches, and what we can do sort of philosophically at the kind of highfalutin level.
Yeah.
But what I don't address is the political question. And here I'll admit that I was, when I finished this book, I was fairly pessimistic about what could be done politically.
Yeah.
But I think even in the last 6 months, 1 year, I'm actually more optimistic about what can be done politically. Because I think that you're seeing, I mean, in certainly in certain inchoate forms in the movement that ended up supporting Donald Trump.
Mm-hmm.
For all of his, you know, for all of his admitted faults as a human being, tapping into some deep discontents with the current order, and yeah. moving, sort of trying to creep its way toward articulating what would a society look like that, you know, is ground on a conception of solidarity.
Mm-hmm.
Of identity with a common tradition and a common history isn't simply a kind of theoretical relationship that liberalism proposes to citizens, mm-hmm. But seeks a kind of form of membership and belonging. I think in Trump's own articulation, it's too much focused on the nation, okay. And I would like to see this thought of or reconsidered as a kind of community of communities, the nation as a community of communities. Right. It's too big and inchoate to really seem to me bear the and to be able to deliver on the demands of solidarity that I think we're witnessing.
Right.
And we're seeing this, of course, in Western Europe as well.
Yeah.
In the so-called populist movements,
yeah.
And I think that if given and if led by what I would see as probably a next generation mm-hmm. of leaders who can really articulate a very positive vision
right.
of what is being, you know, I think just slowly articulated through these kind of political responses, mm-hmm. there might be much more room for this kind of a political possibility than I allowed for at the end of the book. And so in this sense, I would give Professor Vermeule some shout out in noting perhaps too much pessimism on that score.
Yeah. Very good. Then we were just going to discuss the political referendums that you spoke about. So that was great with Donald Trump and Brexit and the Italian elections. I think you could see that as a result of this post-liberal world. Do you have time for one more question?
Oh, sure.
Okay. So a few years ago, you wrote an article entitled How a Generation Lost Its Common Culture. You said the education system ultimately produced a generation of know-nothings. And as a professor, you could speak to, you see this firsthand. How does education in America today reflect the moral and cultural decline of civil society? And do you think this can be fixed?
But yeah, that article was written as I was teaching a sort of a big introductory level class at the University of Notre Dame, and you know we regularly get the top, you know, top students, the best applicants. We brag constantly. Our SAT numbers are higher. Our class rank is higher. And you know, I just in the course of that class, I was just tossing out some basic questions, just thinking, okay, you know, let's just establish a baseline of the things that we know. So, you know, how did Socrates die? Who fought in the Peloponnesian War? I mean, there's some basic questions that anyone with a halfway decent education in the Western tradition would be able to answer. And, you know, pretty much across the board, my students did not know the answer to these very basic questions. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I wrote this piece and certain number of readers read this and said, wow, what a horrible professor to, you know, attack and criticize my students. I wasn't criticizing my students.
Right, yeah.
I was criticizing the adults. Mm-hmm. I was criticizing my generation. Yeah. And in fact, what I was saying was that we have robbed you.
Yeah.
And we're literally in the process of robbing you in terms of money by giving you as an inheritance debt. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But we have also robbed you from your rightful inheritance of a civilization.
Right.
And I said, and I concluded that not only was this a form of theft, but that it was at a deep level intentional theft, mm-hmm. that it was in fact the purpose of the modern educational model to deprive, to raise a generation with no actual knowledge of their past. And because this was the aim of, you could say, broadly speaking, a civilization that wants people to have no roots, to be rootless, nomadic, you know, people without a tradition, you know, to go back to the argument of my book, people without a culture, people without a sense that there's a past mm-hmm. that preceded their births, and there will be a future that continues after their deaths. And this to me is the hallmark of what a civilization is, which is the capacity of every generation to connect itself to the story of what preceded and the story of what will follow after my little bit in this temporal time. And by depriving our students of that part in that narrative, we as the adults in the room have committed, to my mind, a kind of act of civilizational theft.
Right.
And that was the argument of the mm-hmm. essay. Now, what got a lot of attention was my indictment of my students.
Yeah.
But I was merely mm-hmm. saying, look, you know, this is an example of just how poorly we have done as the grown-ups. And that was really the thrust of that argument.
Right.
It is a much tamer criticism than Alan Bloom's The Closing of the American Mind, written in the 1980s.
I'm not sure if it was tamer, but it was. I would hope it was in keeping with what in Bloom was.
Right.
Bloom was also
right.
in many
right.
ways saying the students that he was seeing, which he said had such open minds that their minds were now closed, that this was also the consequence of the kind of education that they had been given mm-hmm. before they got to mm-hmm. college. So I was simply, I think, continuing a kind of argument that Bloom made. I had classes with Bloom as a graduate student at the University of Chicago.
Yeah.
So I'm an admirer. I still assign his book, and I think a lot about what he would have to say about today's education system.
Yeah.
I'm sure he wouldn't hold back.
Yeah, I'm sure he wouldn't. Professor Deneen, you have been very generous with your time, and we really appreciate your very fruitful insights on the show today. Hopefully we'll have Adrian Vermeul or Rod Dreyer on our show in future episodes to continue the conversation. You're welcome back at any time, and really appreciate you coming on the show today.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. For those who were wondering, the two questions pitched by Patrick Deneen, which were also in his article, the answers were Socrates died by drinking hemlock, and the two who fought in the Peloponnesian War were Athens and Sparta. So if you're wondering if you got them correct, there you go. We hope you enjoyed this episode, and we really thank you for joining us. And of course, we thank Mr. Deneen for spending his morning with us to discuss these questions and his book. Please do not forget to become an active Team ROP member by visiting our Patreon page, patreon.com/rightonpoint, linked on the Get Involved page on our website. By donating as little as $1 per month, as you know, you can get access to exclusive Patreon-only content and help our burgeoning community grow. We also want to hear from you, and we are passionate about responding to your feedback, so please email us at ROP@rightonpointpodcast.com, and we will read your responses on our upcoming shows.
Again, our Facebook is facebook.com/ROP podcast. Twitter is twitter.com/ROP podcast. Instagram @rightonpointpodcast. Our Patreon is patreon.com/rightonpoint. And our email is ROP@rightonpointpodcast.com. And last but not least, our website, rightonpointpodcast.com. That's www.rightonpointpodcast.com. where you can find articles, news, extra content, and so much more.
And now for the quote of the day. The failure to read good books both enfeebles the vision and strengthens our most fatal tendency, the belief that the here and now is all there is. That was by Alan Bloom.
Today's word of the day, we're already on the letter P, and that's peregrination. Thank you for listening to this episode of Right on Point.
I'm Olivia Ingracia.
And I'm Paul Ingracia. We thank Mr. Deneen on behalf of all of us here at the Right on Point podcast. And that's the way it is. God bless.